working in conjunction with our friend Manny from Cisco to go over the software defined WAN 101. Wrong button. So first off, what we're going to go through today, we're going to kind of give you an overview of what SD-WAN is, and then we'll get into the overall architecture of the SD-WAN solution, and provide as well as an overview of the orchestration and automation options that are provided with Cisco SD-WAN solution. And Manny will also be providing a demo of the APIC-EM IWAN application as well. To jump right in, just to give a quick overview about why SD-WAN is important in the business market today. The conversion and centralization of applications into clouds and data centers and private clouds is putting more and more importance on the WAN. So having WAN services that are flexible, secure, and even more available is greatly important. Looking at some of the statistics, more than 80% of our users are now at what we consider a remote office. So that means that they have to access applications and services over a WAN. And applications and bandwidth uses are increasing by 20 to 50% year over year. Again, putting more stress on your WAN. And then, as we all know, there is the pervasive threat of security, which means that security has to be a very high, very, very important piece of any kind of SD-WAN solution. Additionally, budgets are getting constrained. IDG points out that 58% of the IT budget is spent on WAN connectivity. So if we can successfully mitigate some of that budget by providing a lower cost but more robust services, we can help move some of that budget spend to other places to the business that may have more impact on revenue and business success. So if you look at what SDN can deliver, what it's really all about is improving application performance and delivering those applications to the users at remote branches in a manner that is not only quick, fast, but secure. We also want to deliver more bandwidth to the user at a lower cost, reduce your complexity, and in wrapping that completely together with a secure solution. Some of the drivers for SD-WAN, a big one is commodity transports, such as the internet, are now viable. Where before the internet, availability on the internet services would not be what we could consider enterprise grade. We're now seeing availability of internet circuits in the 98, 99% availability range. In addition to that, with internet bandwidth, commodity internet bandwidth, we're also seeing that we can get dramatically more performance for a cost versus your traditional IP services such as MPLS or dark fiber lines. So what is SD-WAN? I'm kind of talking about the business drivers there, but what is SD-WAN? So this definition and this diagram come from the Open Network User Group of giving you what the different components of an SD-WAN solution are. So if you look at what we're looking at, ideally or primarily the WAN devices should be physical or virtual. You should be able to deploy them with zero touch. I like to always say zero touch, except for the fact that we haven't found a way to define software to take a router out of a box yet. So we still have to have people for that. Maybe we'll have robots someday, but right now we're still opening up the boxes and putting them in the racks and connecting them to networking. And then we should have interoperability between your layer 2 and layer 3 networks. We also want to have some of the primary tenets of being able to dynamically engineer traffic across your paths. And in this case, you can see the diagram is using an MPLS provider for one path and an internet provider for another. We want those to be active-active, so we can actually utilize both circuits at the same time. We don't want to any longer remain on the active path passive path where we're basically just have half of our bandwidth sitting there for an emergency. And we also want to be this all to be resilient, highly resilient and highly available. Finally, we want to be our additionally, we want to be able to see what every application, what the priority of every application is doing on the network. And we want to have this all wrapped into a management dashboard and with an open API so we can do software-based management and software-based programming on it together. So what that means, so Cisco's offering in this market, as some may be aware, is known as Cisco IWAN. And what Cisco IWAN provides is a platform to build your SD-WAN-based solutions over using well-known, well-deployed technologies in a very prescriptive manner. So we have four tenets of an IWAN solution. That is transport independence. It's transport independence, which means we're going to be able to provide you WAN services regardless of your IP network, be that MPLS, 3G, 4G, or internet. We're going to be able to have intelligent path control. So we're going to use a prescriptive controller-based, policy-based method to intelligently direct traffic over your network based on the business requirements you dictate. We're going to be able to optimize that traffic by using compression algorithms, TCP window sizing optimizations, and then, of course, all of that's going to be wrapped around a secure, comprehensive threat defense mechanism. And all those taken together is the Cisco IWAN architecture. And with that overview, I'm going to hand the rest of the next part of the presentation over to Manny, and he's going to take us into a little greater depth of each of the four tenets of Cisco IWAN and SD-WAN as I just described. Manny, thanks for joining us, and the presentation is yours.
Great. Thank you, Michael. Just to introduce myself, my name is Manny Ganesan. I'm one of the senior product managers in the IWAN product group at Cisco. We've been working with this group ever since the birth of IWAN. We've been architecting the solution in different ways. We have a huge adoption. It's still growing, like 200-plus customers running the solution in large scale, and there's more and more customers adopting the software-defined way as well. So we'll talk about what the solution entails, what are the different components, take a little bit deeper view of each of the component of the solution. And then in the last 5 minutes or so, we will look at the demo of our software-defined application, what we call as IWAN application. So you could just deploy IWAN within a matter of a few minutes. So that's it. I'm going to talk about each of the pillars that Michael laid out. The first one is transport independence. So where does the name come from? Why are we calling it as transport independence? And this is the foundation of the IWAN architecture as well. What it really means is we're kind of abstracting away from what type of transport it is. It doesn't matter whether it's a private MPLS or any type of layer 2 private connection like VPLS, E-line, or anything like that. Or it could be a public internet like broadband connection at a remote location. Or in some cases, it could be just a 4G LTE connection. It's all wireless. So we, as a router, it doesn't matter what type of transport it is. We're going to abstract and move away from worrying about what type of connection it is. We will build secure tunnels on top of every connection. So then you would not worry about what routing protocol do I run on each of the connections, right? It's not like, okay, if it's MPLS connection, I will run BGP, and then on my LAN side and my VPN side, I'll run something like OSPF or EIGRP, and then I redistribute. So we are moving away from all those models, no more two-way redistribution and all of that. We're going to keep it simple, just on a simple overlay protocol across all type of transport. And then we are going to move away from basic IP routing. We're going to make routing more application aware. We'll talk about that as well. So what do we need for that? When we thought about what should be the technology, you know, Cisco always had a whole bunch of VPN technologies. And when we were testing out with a bunch of customers, we figured DMVPN would fit the model exactly here, right? I mean, think of sites with the 2,000 remote locations. And when we had that, we need a protocol that is tested out at scale, which is highly secure, a proven technology that, that customers understand. And then the biggest differentiation here is the spoke-to-spoke dynamic tunnels. For those of you who have worked with DMVPN, we do not need to configure, let's say you have 1,000 sites or let's say even 200 sites, you don't need to build point-to-point tunnels between all of these locations. This is a point-to-multipoint technology. You just configure the tunnel once on all these routers, and as traffic comes along, let's say site A wants to talk to site B and both are remote locations, even though you do not have a tunnel configured, it automatically builds a dynamic tunnel and then sends traffic over it. It's a secure IPsec tunnel as well. And as soon as the traffic stops, let's say it could be a voice call, the traffic stops, the call is dropped. Immediately after that, the tunnel gets torn down. But this is great because you're able to scale much better using a technology like DMVPN. If you look at the topology here, so let's say we have a data center with multiple border routers. And from a remote location, we have an MPLS circuit and then we have an internet circuit. We are building DMVPN tunnel across both of this. From a router perspective, so you could just run one routing protocol on top of this. Let's say you finalize BGP is going to be a protocol or EAGRP is the protocol. You just run that protocol across both type of transport. So what is that circuit providing to you? That circuit is just providing WAN connectivity. As long as there is IP connectivity between the WAN interfaces, we're good there. We don't have to worry about advertising our routes into the provider, the network, and all of that. And also, this is a great advantage here. Think of the failover scenario. Let's say you are advertising your routes into the provider network, and then they propagate the routes through multiple hops and then reaches your data center. If something goes wrong within the cloud, and then most of them are running BGP as a protocol, they have route reflectors, BGP as a protocol is designed to scale. However, the fast failover was not one of the design tenets when they came up with the protocol. You know, there is a long failover time, and then you have to send withdrawal messages to your route reflector to tell that there is a failure, and then it has to propagate hop by hop. By the time it gets to the data center, you even realize there is a failure on this link. It's going to be at least close to 2 to 3 minutes. That's what we have been seeing with customers. When we take the control back and you're running your own routing protocol on this, in a sort of point-to-point tunnel, that is getting you a much better failover time as well, because as soon as there is a failure, you get to know because it's a point-to-point technology between these two sites. That is another great advantage of running overlay protocols such as DMVPN and on top of all type of transport. And when I present this slide, usually customers ask us, why do I need DMVPN on MPLS? It's supposed to be my private connection through a provider. This is not public internet. Do I still need to secure? And given where the technology is going, and given where how customers think about hacks and attacks, malware that are going on, a lot of customers of us are moving towards encryption everywhere. You know, any type of connectivity outside my enterprise, I always want to encrypt. So, it's a choice, but we always recommend, hey, doesn't matter what type of transport it is, we don't know what type of backbone there is. So just encrypt everything that goes on top of any type of transport. This is the first tenet. Again, that doesn't mean that you always need to have an MPLS connection and internet connection. So we have customers running different types of connection. It doesn't matter. It's always up to what the location has, right? So we have locations that are dual MPLS. Customers that have two MPLS circuits and they want to keep the site that way, and they are building a similar architecture as well, so they could simplify their routing, achieve fast failover, and all of that from this architecture. And the hybrid is the case that we just talked about. And the last case is some cases they have dual internet as well, where they have some type of broadband connection and they have a remote location where there is no MPLS. And in that case, they use something like 4G LTE as a tertiary connection. So they could still have some type of redundancy. If there is like a fiber cut, the wired connectivity goes down. There is 4G LTE, so you wouldn't lose any of your sites that no matter what happens there. That's the first pillar. So once you achieve, this is like the foundation of the IWAN architecture. So you have basic IPsec tunnels running across all the sites. You have kind of the transport independence, what we call as. Then what we are introducing on top of it is this intelligent path control. So this is all about application-aware routing. Now think of it, right? We've been running IP-based routing for many decades now. So what it does is router gets the packet, it looks at the destination IP address, looks at the routing table, and routes the packet on any of the available paths depending on delay or any of the parameters you have set. It has no idea today, like what type of application is it, right? It could be a critical packet. From a routing perspective, it's just layer 3, just cares about IP address. We are changing that with the intelligent path control. We have been using this technology for a while, but this is getting mainstream with the adoption of SD-WAN market. So pretty much what we had prior to this was the optimized edge routing. For those of you who have been using Cisco routers, you know this feature called optimized edge routing or OER. So we've been using this for, again, more than 10 years. So this is not some brand new technology. We always want to lead the market with something that's proven, that's been proven well in the market. So now we have version 3 of PFR. So what we have done is we have completely simplified the way the protocol works. So all you have to do is define your business policies on your hub site, meaning what I mean by those business policies. You could say, similar to your QoS policies, you could say, hey, here are my critical applications. Here is my voice and video. Here are my ERP applications. Here is my point of sale application. And this is what I care about. When I have an MPLS site, I always want to make sure these traffic takes a MPLS path because that is a premium path that I'm paying extra money for, and these are my critical applications. Can you make sure you always send the application on MPLS? And if there is a problem, let's say there is some type of performance issue with an MPLS, they're dropping some packets, they're still troubleshooting it, the router should automatically detect if there is a problem and then shift those applications over to the backup path. It could be another MPLS circuit, or it could be a broadband circuit, it could be a 4G connection, doesn't matter. It should automatically steer the traffic to the alternate path, which is still within the SLA. And what about the rest of the application? That just covers 20% of your applications, right? And the rest of the apps, we are using the best effort model. You don't need to define policies by default. There is a class default bucket, just like QoS. It takes all of those applications, and then it load shares across all the available paths. So it is an active-active architecture. So any circuit that you're paying money for, as long as they're within the SLA, it will always load share on a best effort model for the rest of the apps. So why are we doing this, right? First of all, we are increasing the amount of bandwidth that's available by moving to an active-active architecture. Think of it, let's say you have just a T1 circuit in a remote location through your MPLS provider, and then there is like a 40 meg broadband pipe which is sitting idle because that's just a backup path. By moving to this transport independent architecture and then layering a protocol like PFR, now you have much higher availability of bandwidth, and also you own the SLA now because the SLA is defined on the router. The router is responsible for monitoring the performance of each of the applications, and then it keeps steering the path automatically, so your users will never get to know if there was a WAN failure, if there was a WAN degradation. You know, it doesn't have to be a complete blackout, right? There is a slide that talks about brownout scenario as well, meaning if it could be just a performance dip, it automatically steers the path. Let's see how this really works. This is what I just explained. You could define your policies like, again, it could be going back to your private cloud, or it could be something like a public cloud application or a SaaS application. You could define your policies saying my voice and video and other critical applications always take MPLS as long as it's within the SLA. If there is a problem, the dotted line shows it is a backup path for those critical applications. And the purple line shows everything else is load balance, so according to the availability of bandwidth, so you utilize all the available paths. So this is the biggest use case for PFR, or what we call as intelligent path control. Again, if there are questions, if you want to understand more, just put it on the chat window, the Q&A window that Michelle mentioned. We will take all of your questions at the end of the session or even during the session. All right, so here is another use case, right? So you have a business app, and there is a high delay that is detected. You stick a path saying this business critical app always takes MPLS path, and if there is a problem, it automatically switches over, and everything else will be best effort traffic. Again, same thing for voice and video, and if there is like a high jitter, the audio quality is going down on a conference call, it automatically detects that and then moves over to the other side. So you have the flexibility of defining when all options are available, here is my preferred path, However, there is a problem. I don't care which path you take, as long as you deliver this application within the SLA that I set for you. And here's the load balancing path. Right? Usually customers ask us, hey, oh, MPLS is a much smaller pipe, whereas my broadband is a much bigger pipe. If you're going to load share, I don't want to overwhelm my MPLS path. We always take care of that. We look at the relative utilization, right? We always keep comparing in terms of percentage, what is the percentage utilization for each of the paths? Even if it's like a T1 circuit, so if it's 750 kilobits per second, there is like a bunch of voice stream going on. We know it's already 50% utilized. Whereas on the internet side, we have a much bigger pipe, so we keep sending some flows on the other side. These are the best effort flows I talked about until it reaches 50% as well. That's about 7.5 megabits per second. And we keep this relative utilization now all the time. And in some cases, let's say you do not want to touch the MPLS circuit for non-critical applications, like things like guest access wireless traffic and some of the browsing traffic. You know, if you allow things like Netflix during your lunch hour, it doesn't matter what your policy is. In that case, you never want those non-critical applications or scavenger type of applications to take the MPLS path. So you can always stick a policy saying, hey, these applications should always take internet. No matter what, if my internet circuit goes down, do not use my MPLS as a backup, right? I'm okay with dropping this packet, but do not take MPLS. So there's a lot of flexibility with the way you could define your policies. So it's all about what you want for your business. What is the business demand? That's all that matters here in PFR. So that's how the protocol works. When we get into the demo of IWAN app, I will show you how do you define these applications here. This is just to explain the concept of why do we need a technology like PFR. And then the third pillar that Michael explained was application optimization. So far, we have been talking about bandwidth, right? Depending on bandwidth available and depending on the performance, we can steer the path, we can throw some more bandwidth. However, what about latency? Right? I mean, it doesn't matter how much bandwidth you have between two sites. If they are too far apart and you have to go across the other side of the world, you are going to have latency. Your users might still complain there is an application performance issue. So this is sort of the value-added pillar within IWAN, right? This is where people ask, do I need to have all of these technologies that you're explaining for me to run IWAN? Absolutely not. The first two pillars are what we categorize as foundational pillars, right? You achieve transport independence, you have a secure tunnel-based architecture, overlay architecture, and then you have technology like PFR taking care of your application traffic. The rest of what we're going to talk about is what we call as the value-added services on top. So depending on the use case, whether you have two remote sites or so much farther apart, in that case, here are some latency optimization as well. Again, the point I'm driving here is you don't need all of this, so don't get overwhelmed by the fact that we're talking about multiple technologies. We have a bunch of options here, so depending on the use case, we can pick and choose what we want so we can achieve the architecture that Michael laid out. So this is all about latency and also visibility, right? The first thing we are achieving here is the visibility. Most of our customers that we talk to, when we ask the question, hey, what is consuming bandwidth in your network? So what are the top five applications? What are the top 10 applications? It's very hard for anyone to tell, hey, here are the applications. Here is like the average bandwidth it takes. During peak hours, this is what it takes. And because most of them are hidden under HTTP these days, right? As soon as you move applications to the cloud, most of them become like sort of web app, and it's all HTTP. Even within voice and video, you may be using your browser to Skype with someone, you know, that may not be business critical because it's somebody's personal call. And some customers that are using Skype for Business or some other technology, you know, even like Cisco's own technology like Cisco WebEx or some type of video conferencing application, that could be business critical, but both are originated from the same browser. How do you differentiate all that, right? This is where visibility becomes absolutely important. And we provide that with something called AVC. AVC stands for Application Visibility and Control. So this is a suite of features that gets turned on when we turn on AVC. It's all about doing deep packet inspection. When packets go through the router, we're going to look into the packet and say, hey, here are the applications. This is sort of like layer 7 based optimization. That also gives you visibility and gives you control as well. Now, what type of control we are talking about? The PFR technology, which we just talked about, relies on this as well. If you want to build your business policies based on what type of applications they are, so here is where you get the visibility of what apps are running. You know, so I have a whole bunch of applications mentioned here. So our router defines here are the categories of application, and then it does the routing based on those applications. And also QoS, if you want to do QoS policies based on the application signatures, now you could say, if this is this application, I want to mark with this DHCP, and you could control, you can assign more bandwidth, you could put it in the priority queue. So instead of just purely categorizing them based on IP addresses, you're able to categorize them based on the application IDs, application signatures, and so on. So we are able to categorize up to 1,500 applications out of the box, and this includes SSL-based application as well. And also, more importantly, if you have in-house application like enterprise app that was built, custom-built, you could create your own custom signatures, you know, just get the signature for the application, and you could create your own custom app so the router gets to identify your own in-house applications as well. And last one is we have an understanding of what application they are. Now you want to understand how they are performing as well. So ABC Suite has also got performance monitoring and exporting. So for voice and video, we have a separate type of monitoring called media monitoring. It keeps a tab on how are your voice and video calls performing, and you can export this data to any of the tools. We're going to talk about what tools we have available. Or if you are using any other third-party tools for network monitoring, you could export this data because we are using standards-based flexible NetFlow for exporting all this data. So you could use flexible NetFlow, export your application performance time, and also your media monitoring. You have a better understanding of, you could have a dashboard. So within IWAN app, we have an application performance dashboard as well. So you get to go to the dashboard every morning to see how are your applications performing. And if you want to troubleshoot a certain app, so you can just double-click on that and then start troubleshooting a specific application as well. And once we have application visibility, then we get to the latency optimization part. So how do we kind of optimize the amount of traffic that goes across WAN? So what we usually say here is the best amount of traffic that could go across the WAN is the traffic that doesn't go across, right? Because that is the best performing traffic. How do we get to that stage? We have technologies like Cisco WAS. WAS has been that for a while as well. Again, this is according to our principle, we always wanted to use that as the technologies that have been proven well in the market, right? Again, WAS, if you look at the latest Gartner Magic Quadrant, this is on the leader quadrant now, WAS is leading because it is well integrated into an overall IWAN solution. So what we say to customers is, you can run IWAN and WAS is integrated into ISR routers as well. So when you run this ISR 4K or ISR G2 based routers to run DMV, PN, and PFR, now you always get to run technologies like WAS along with it. It's well integrated into the existing solution, so you don't need extra box to run technologies like this. First is application optimization, which is TCP-based optimization. You're kind of removing the redundant data, the duplicate data that get across the WAN, right? So you're eliminating all of that. And the newest thing here is our partnership with Akamai. Again, Akamai has been there in the market as a content delivery provider for a long time. I mean, they've been best in the market in what they do. So what we have done with them is we have kind of got their secret sauce of how do they cache the application and then add it to the WAS solution here. So what does it really mean? Think of what Akamai does today. We are able to do that all the way up to the last mile. What Akamai does is when you are, so most of the biggest content providers, think of Facebook, YouTube, even Cisco.com, some of the biggest websites that you could name, they all go through Akamai. So it doesn't matter where the user is. They don't have to go to the data center of that provider. They just need to go to Akamai's closest data center. So the content is cached over there. With this technology, what we're doing is we are extending that into the ISR router itself. Now you get to cache different things here. A couple of examples I like talking about is Apple iOS update. And you could equate this to any other smartphone as well. Apple has been talked about because it was always hard to cache Apple iOS. I mean, the size of the file is really, really large. It's like a 1 gig file. Let's say iOS 10 comes out, and 10 of us in the remote office are sitting and trying to download iOS 10 from the remote office, which means if we do not have a technology like this, for every single user, you go across the WAN, and then you try to download that 1 gig file 10 different times. But what Akamai has figured out is they have a secret sauce to find out, okay, this is the same file coming over and over again. It caches the first time when the user goes out. For the subsequent users, it's always fetched from the local server. It's sort of like LAN-like performance for files like Apple, iOS, YouTube. Again, a lot of customers of us are using YouTube as a training mechanism. And then the biggest problem with YouTube is it's dynamic URL. Even though you and I in the same room could be watching the same video, however, it gives us two different URLs for us, right? But Akamai has found out the mechanism to cache that as well. Even though the URLs are different, it knows the content that is delivered is exactly the same. So for the rest of the users, they don't have to go across the WAN. There are multiple things like this. Again, for retail users, digital signage is a big thing, and also HD video content for their sales rep. What they're doing is they're starting to pre-position the content. What I mean by pre-positioning, you know, during non-peak hours, overnight, you could pre-position the newly released HD video into all of your branch routers overnight. So when the users or customers walk in the next morning, they're not going across the WAN and nobody is complaining because the content is already positioned. So when they try to download or watch the stream, it always comes from the local router. There's plenty of use cases here. Again, if you have your own video application that you use for all hands, if you use for any of the other training, you could leverage some of these technologies in your remote locations. So this is integrated as a part of IWAN solution now. That has been our biggest differentiator. That is why Gartner has put on top of rest of the vendors to show that we need an integrated solution with all of the other portfolio, including routing, the tunneling, and all those technologies as well. This is the VAS and Akamai piece. And again, here it shows the difference here, right? VAS and Akamai, even though they're two different solutions, they serve different needs. VAS has always been about TCP optimization. You can deduplicate the data, so it kind of eliminate the amount of data, reduce the amount of data that goes across the WAN. They also have some application-specific accelerations. Think of VDI and thin client type use cases, Citrix. We have some specific use cases for VAS. And then for Akamai Connect, it's all about HTTP cache, right? Transparent cache, which is any content across the internet. And dynamic URL cache is the YouTube we talked about. And Akamai connected cache, if Akamai has already cached something within the cloud, within Akamai's cloud, that also kind of gets pulled directly into the ISR router and content pre-positioning. So we have different use cases depending on what your current pain point is. We can pick one of these solutions or both of these solutions. Michelle, quick check, any questions on the chat window so far?
Yes, we do. The one question that's come in is, how is an application defined?
Great question. I'll take it right now, and then we'll address the rest of the questions at the end as well. So applications can be defined in multiple ways. So in today's network, we have two types of customers. Some of them really want to use the DHCP marking. I mean, you define your policies for PFR. What they do is they already have marked their traffic on the LAN side. Let's say voice and video, voice is always marked EF, video is marked AF41. They are so comfortable with DHCP. We are providing them an option to reuse DHCP for those routing policies as well. So when they define their PFR routing policies, they get to use the DHCP, and then they can build them for, if it is DHCP EF, it should always take this path. You get to define your policies like that. And if you're going the application, purely application-based way, then it's the NBAR, the network-based application recognition. You just turn on NBAR. Again, when you turn on PFR, it automatically does everything in the background. So it detects all the application. When you define your policies, you can define class for, okay, it shows the 1500 out-of-the-box application. You can use the application ID. Okay, here is WebEx, here is Skype, and here is the video application, telepresence. So you could define those applications like that as well. And if you're using an orchestration tool like APKM IWAN app, which I'm going to show in a couple of minutes, you get to define applications based on that as well. Out of the box, it shows all the applications that are running in your network. You just get to drag and drop so you can build your policies based on that. So that's how we will build applications. All right, so real quick, I will talk about the last pillar, the IWAN secure connectivity, and then jump into the demo so we get to see how an IWAN network is built. Secure connectivity is all about, you know, let's say you have a remote location, and when you send traffic across a public domain like a broadband internet, how do you secure traffic? So all about encryption, so you don't want your branch network to be exposed out to the whole world, so you want to secure everything that goes out. So we have different mechanisms. We use a technology called front door WRF, or VRF. What we do is all of your WAN interfaces will be in a separate virtual routing table. So by that, when you build the secure tunnels, they will be running on a global table, but your WAN-facing network, be it MPLS or be it broadband internet or be it 4G, they will always be in a separate WRF. So even somebody you have access list, firewall, and all of that, this adds an extra layer of security, right? So your routing table for that network is completely separate. So your WAN network and your LAN network or enterprise network are in two different routing domains. So that gives an additional layer of security as well. And also, this is, the secure pillar is all about secure internet access. When you're using internet as your WAN, and customers asked us when we introduced this technology, can I just go straight from my branch to internet? You know, they have specific use cases. The commonly seen use cases are guest access wireless. Say, hey, have a guest access VLAN. Customers walk in, they keep browsing. I don't want to take this browsing traffic back into my data center. I don't want to waste my precious bandwidth, my MPLS bandwidth. Can I straight away offload this traffic? The answer is yes, so we have use cases for that. And also, some customers say, I have a trusted relationship with my public cloud provider, be it Microsoft Azure, Amazon, you name it, right? Even SaaS providers, Office 365, Salesforce. When my remote users want to go to the public cloud to access these applications, do they have to come back to my data center, get backhauled, and then help it back into public cloud? The answer is no. They can go straight to public cloud as well. And then the biggest question is, how do I secure all of this? So that is what we address here in this section. We have a whole bunch of security portfolio that are integrated into IWAN, and we are adding more and more technologies as well. As we acquire, as our security portfolio gets bigger and bigger, think of the companies that Cisco has acquired, right? The SourceFire, OpenDNS, Talos, and there's a bunch of security companies that we are working with, and we are trying to integrate all of them into IWAN, so our IWAN security portfolio is the most robust for remote branches. Okay, the first thing first, this is all about encryption. When you send traffic across the overlay network, everything needs to be secure. Again, we are using DMVPN with IPsec. And we have strong cryptography, and also we are using front door WRF. So the WAN-facing interfaces are always in a separate network. And router has embedded firewall as well, a zone-based firewall. So you can separate out your inside and outside zone. And we also have the router-based access list. The router, in turn, can access your firewall as well. In addition to that, in the latest ISR 4K routers, the 4000 series, we have additional containers. The additional cores to CPU, we are able to run containers on it and run things like IPS. If you want to kind of replicate what you got in your data center, if you want to distribute your security architecture, you don't need to keep adding more and more appliances, right? What we say is you have the facility to add all of that into the router. The IPS IDS, web filtering using OpenDNS, and if you really prefer a cloud-based security mechanism, and there is an option for that as well. So real quick, here are the router security certifications. For those of you who have been using ISR, you know FIPS compliance, EAL4, and the strong crypto compliance. That's pretty much everything that's there in the market. We have certified our routers. So this is not some brand new box in the market that you need to worry about, right? This is, we are reusing the existing ISR routers. Doesn't matter if you have ISR G2 routers. Think of those 28, 29, and 3900s. If you have them and you want to take the first step by moving into an IWAN architecture, and then when you're ready, you want to move to the next generation routers, 4K, absolutely possible. Or if you already have 4K series routers and you want to run, you could reuse them as well. So we don't need additional boxes to run a technology like IWAN. And zone-based firewall, it's been there in the market as well, so we have a bunch of options. So you get to create different zones, the outside zone and inside zone, and also the self zone. So different zones of the interfaces are, you know, you can build policies for each of the zones. So you can, you get to decide who can talk to who, and you get to do some deep packet inspection as well. And here's the secure option I talked about. I mean, customers want to go straight to public cloud. They ask us, I don't want to run anything on-premise. I really prefer a cloud-based architecture. Do you have a cloud-based security solution? Absolutely. And we have a solution called cloud-based security. So what this does is think of this as your cloud-based web proxy, right? So you build a secure tunnel from your remote location to cloud web security, which is Cisco's cloud, and where all of these security functions are running, your malware protection, antivirus, web-based filtering, and pretty much everything is running in that cloud. When packet goes out, you kind of mark what packet is going out, and when packet comes back from the cloud, if somebody has eavesdropped and remarked something, you get to see whether it's the malware, if there is any virus, you get to see all of that, and then send the traffic back to the branch. So this is all cloud-based. You get to keep your branch as a thin CPE with no additional functions, and you could use a cloud-based option as well. And here's how it really works. You have all these options, and you get to build your policies. So let's say you don't want to send everybody straight to internet. Let's say your employees should always go back to the data center because you have a much robust security solution in your data center, and only for guest access users because they are in their own VRS, they're in their own VLAN. You want to send traffic out, now you get to do that as well. So it's all about how do you want to build your security architecture. All right, the last part that I want to quickly cover here is the orchestration. The biggest differentiation in the market has always been, okay, I like all of this. I like what you talked about, DMVP and PFR, application optimization. How do I build this? And one of the key tenets that Michael talked about earlier was simplicity, right? Because you want to keep your WAN architecture simple, and you want to know what's going on there in terms of visibility, and troubleshooting should be easier as well. So we are moving into the software-defined approach as well with this. So APKM is our software controller, or the SDN controller for the overall enterprise. Again, we have a whole bunch of applications running on top of the controller, and IWAN is one of them. What does the controller do? So we are abstracting away from the type of devices, right? Think of, again, this is for the whole enterprise, not just for your WAN site. It talks to different types of devices, like, you know, you have catalyst switches as your LAN switches, you have Nexus in the data center, ISR in the branch, ASR in the data center, ASA wireless, so on and so forth. So you don't have to worry about individual devices now. What does the configuration look like? So on southbound, you have an abstraction. The controller talks to each of this. All you do is talk to the controller and build your policies, right? So you get to build your LAN policies, you get to build your WAN policies for IWAN, you get to build your QoS policies. That is a software-defined approach. Again, when you get this controller, you don't have to worry about running different things for your other part of the network, your wireless and catalyst. That is another biggest differentiator with IWAN. The customers that are running IWAN today, they're also thinking about an integrated architecture for their LAN side, like, because you know, LAN is eventually moving towards software defined, and they don't want to have a turn of the controller from somebody else and do to all that. They want a single platform that could be their software defined mechanism so they could build all of their common policies on top of it. That's a direction we're moving towards. So pretty much you define your policies where your controller would be running in your data center. Think of this sort of like network management tool. Again, this is not your network management. This is much more than that. But just as an analogy, so you get to run this in a data center that kind of pushes the policies to all of these routers. And so when you define your WAN policies, you don't have to worry about the configuration commands for DMVP and a PFR, building each and every command line. So you get to build your policies, it gets pushed down automatically. So this is where I want to differentiate another point. So some customers say, hey, I'm not completely ready for software defined, right? I like this, probably sometime down the line I want to run this, but I still want to see what CLI it is pushing, right? Like say the APKM IWAN Ambus is purely for the software defined market. You just want to talk business policies. You don't want to see what the CLI is doing, right? So you're kind of giving the control to that application. However, if you want to take the middle ground, you like the automation part of it, but you still want to keep control of what CLI is pushing. You understand CLI to a certain extent. You want to see what does the configuration look like. we have an option through Cisco Prime. So we have introduced an IWAN workflow, IWAN wizard within Cisco Prime. So you get to see each and every pillar of it, all the way from DMVPN. It takes you step by step. So you get to build your configuration once and push out the configuration to all of the remote site locations. So you just build it once and scale it through the tool. For this, let's say you want to customize things, you want to kind of, because IWAN app is all about Cisco validated design. It uses CVD best practices. It doesn't show you a lot of CLI commands. Cisco Prime is sort of the middle ground. And then we have some ecosystem partners that are working with us. Live Action, a fantastic partner for visualizing PFR. Okay, PFR is going to dynamically change path. You know, let's say your application performance drops. It is changing from MPLS to INET or vice versa. You want to exactly know what's going on. So this gives a beautiful visualization of what is going on in the network. It shows the flows in different colors. So each color would mean different path. And this is sort of like your DVR for your application traffic as well. Let's say some user complained that they had some issue at 2 a.m. in the morning when they were accessing application. You get to go back in time and look at the specific application flow, see if it was QoS or routing or what was going on in the network. Glue is a different type of partner. We are using them for cloud-based orchestration. They do a great work where everything talks back to the cloud, and you get to define your policies in the cloud. And this is, think of this as Meraki. If you are exposed to the Meraki concept, this is sort of Meraki for your traditional portfolio, right? So everything calls home into the cloud. It gets you better policies, and policies are pushed out to all of the devices. That's the partner we are working with. So that said, in the last few minutes, I just want to jump back into the demo and show you what does the application performance look like, or what does the tool look like, real quick. Let me go back here. I'm going to share my app real quick. All right, so this is what it looks like. Let me make sure it's still logged in. It is not. So I'm going to use my username password real quick. This is the enterprise SDN controller I talked about. We are running the version 1.3. This is a lab version. So if you currently download it from CCO, you will see a 1.2 version. This is sort of the beta release we are working internally with, but pretty much the same concept. You will see a bunch of applications here. We are adding more and more apps. We have an app for QoS, and we have something called plug and play. This is for the zero touch. And we will be mostly focusing on IWAN. But before that, the workflow would always start from network plug and play. Let's say you're deploying a router, and when you connect a router, it should be completely zero touch. A new router, you know, let's say you drop ship the router into a remote location straight away. There is no more pre-staging. Nobody is opening up the box in between. It gets shipped to the remote location straight away if you want. And then it has a default bootstrap configuration. Pretty much it calls into a specific portal, and then you have access to the portal. You can say, this is this serial number. This is the APKM controller address. So it knows where to call home to. So that way you don't need anybody logging on to the router or putting a bootstrap configuration. We are automating the bootstrap process as well. And when the device calls home, it's going to show up as there are a bunch of unclaimed devices. Could you confirm this is your device? So you get to see the serial number and claim it. In this case, I just claimed a couple of devices. Here is an ISR 4431. Here's the serial number. I just claimed it. The moment I say claim the device, and it shows up in my IWAN portal as well. And this is what the IWAN portal looks like. This is the homepage of IWAN. It takes you to everything step by step. But before that, look, this is the application dashboard we talked about. Out of the box, it shows you the different categories of application. This is business relevant, and here are different categories. This is voice and video. If you click on voice and video, it's going to show you different types of application. You can go through each one of these. And it also shows the different groups you configured. What is business relevant? What is business irrelevant? What is class default? And also, what is the application path preference? Are you preferring your MPLS for this application? Are you preferring INET? This is sort of your the dashboard that you get to start with. And also, it also shows how many devices are newly discovered. And so you get to see when devices come here, as soon as you claim the device through plug and play, it shows here are the devices. You can assign device to a specific site. And even for brownfield, let's say you're not doing a brand new deployment. You already have a router running in the branch. You could manually add the device using the IP address, this is sort of like a typical network management model, right? This is the brownfield option. So the point here is everything doesn't have to be greenfield. You could add a device and then start configuring IWAN policies for an existing branch router as well. Or if you want to do bootstrap, you could do bootstrap IP address as well. So going through different steps real quick, now as soon as you enter IWAN, the first thing you set up is your hub site. And you just set up all of these options like NetFlow, SNMP, the basic parameters. And here is where you certify your routers. Depending on the models you have in your network, you certify a specific IOS based on recommendation. You always pick a long-lived release and say any device that comes out, this is the image I want to put in. Depending on the model, it automatically pushes new IOS release as well. And you give the IP address pool, so they know, so it automates the assigning of IP address to the DMVP internals. Let's say you assign a /24 pool, and for all the remote locations, be it hundreds or thousands, it picks an IP address from that and applies the IP address here. And you get to pick your service provider, whether you have two MPLS, one MPLS, internet, and what type of QoS is supported by your MPLS provider. Kind of you give the basic things about different sites. And this is where you configure your hub site. How many transports you got? Do you have two MPLS and one internet, three MPLS, one internet, different combinations? You just drag and drop the router, go through each step, and then if you want to add another router to this, you can add another router. So to the hub, this will become a third router. Or if you want another data center, so you have two data centers, you can add another data center. Pretty much build your topology here. And then you go to each and every step, and then say, here is my IP address of the WAN. You just provide the basic parameters of what is your WAN interface, what is your address, what is the default gateway address. That's about it. That's all you do in terms of your hub site. I'm just going through real quick just to show what the interface looks like. And you can always download this and play around with this in the lab as well. And then the important part is configuring your remote location. This is where you claim the device. You can claim any device. In this case, I'm just picking a router in Canada, and then I say provision the router. It will ask you what type of topology is it. Is it a single router with two different transport, a single router, single transport? So in this case, you can pick and choose. Let's say you have two individual routers, each with one separate connection. You can pick and choose that as well. In this case, let's say I pick this model. I go through this. It's going to ask me to pull certain things. What is the IP address and so on. So you go through all of this and push all of the parameters here. So once you configure a remote site, the most important part is configuring your application policies. So the first two steps are providing you basic connectivity, basic overlay tunnels, and all of that. So this is where you configure all of your application policies. So out of the box, based on NBAR, it categorizes the applications that are running in your network. Okay, here is the database application. Okay, here is the Oracle server, that's MySQL server, and it just gives out of the box, here is your instant messaging. There's a Yahoo Messenger, somebody is using Google Talk, somebody is using WhatsApp. It categorizes, recognizes all of that. Here are different voice and video applications, and if you think some of these are not supposed to be as business critical, you get to do drag and drop. You can say, hey, even though it's categorized by default voice and video, this is not allowed as a part of my enterprise policies. You could just remove it from there. And you could just define application policies. Let's say Let's say file sharing is not business critical for you. You just drag and drop into non-business critical. And then you get to pick what is the path you want to prefer. Is it MPLS or INET and so on? And it also provides you application bandwidth. So this is how simple it is to build your application policies, and it configures your QoS and PFR as well. That's your day one, and lastly, day two is monitoring and troubleshooting, and it shows you a whole map of where are your remote locations, and it shows different sites. It's not showing right now, but you can just click on any site and then troubleshoot any issues that are going on. So we're adding some analytics engine as well. It automatically shows you a possible root cause. Hey, it could be a routing loop. It could be a misconfiguration of loopback address based on what it has seen from other customer cases, stack case database, and all of that gives you a possible root cause. Okay, so that's all I had to show, Michael. I realize we just have a couple of minutes. I want to pass it back to you so you could wrap up the call, and then we can take some questions. Yeah.
Great. Thanks, Manny. Just to wrap it up, that was a great demo. You mind passing me the ball real quick, and I'll just go over the last couple items.
Yep, I just passed the ball.
Perfect. So just wanted to kind of give a little bit of a wrap up on GTRI's SDN practice and where we stand. We definitely have a wide tier of SDN solutions that we can assist your business with. We also do have some very deep experience with Cisco IWAN SD-WAN solution. So if your business is interested in looking or discussing further any of the information that you're looking at today, we're currently offering a free, basically 3-hour, half-day SDN review for your company, how the solutions can help you, and how we can partner together as your company and as GTRI to further implement any kind of SDN technologies, SD-WAN technologies that you're looking to provide. So if you're looking, if you're interested in that offering, please don't hesitate to reach out to GTRI and inquire further. With that, I think we have a few minutes left for any kind of Q&A questions. Michelle, do you have some questions, any questions out there in the Q&A?
Yeah, thanks, Manny, and thank you, Michael. The one question that came in is there a throughput limit when IPsec is applied on the ISR routers?
Sure, I can take it, and then, Michael, I'll give it to you for your response as well. So, sure. We are using ISR 4K as a preferred architecture for IWAN. The 4K series has different cores assigned for data plane and control plane. So with the multi-core architecture, even with IPsec, we are seeing the performance not drop at all, actually. So in some cases, even if you have heavy encryption going on, because we have dedicated CPU cores for just encryption and your data plane features, we wouldn't see a performance impact for that because the box has been architected in such a way. So we assign certain CPUs for certain functions. If you're using some older generation routers, you've got to be a little careful with how much encryption you do because you want to keep because it's common core architecture and you want to keep an eye. It doesn't mean that it's going to see a huge performance drop, but we always caution our customers with the older G1s and G2s, just keep an eye because depending on throughput, you may see a drop, but with the 4K routers, we have a completely different architecture. So Michael, do you want to add something?
Yeah, I think that covers it. Only other thing to be aware of, for all of the routers, there are some governmental regulations around encryption throughput. So if you, I believe it's 85 meg. So if you buy a router with, and you need more than 85 meg of encryption, just be aware that there is one additional license that we would apply at a nominal charge, just to make sure that the government regulations are adhered to.
Great. Well, it looks like we are at the top of the hour, so thank you everyone for joining us today, and a copy of this presentation along with a link to the recording of today's session will be emailed out next week. Thank you for joining.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone. Appreciate your time.